Okay.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to see you. Welcome to Cornerstone Presbyterian Church this morning. Glad you're here. And happy Father's Day to all you dads out there. So welcome. It's good to see you, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord together. If you're joining us through live stream, welcome. Glad that you're here joining us. And if you're visiting with us either by live stream or in person here, we are so glad to have you. You're our guest. We'd love to get to know you. And towards the back end of your bulletin, there is a virtual visitor card with a QR code. You can go to that, follow that link there. We'd love to just have a record of your attendance and a way to reach out to you, whether you're in person here or joining us via live stream. We're just glad that you're here, and we welcome you. A few announcements before we begin our service of worship this morning, and you can find all of these on the back page of your bulletin. Coming up in a few weeks, we're going to host another Exploring Cornerstone class for anyone that's interested in learning more about our church, maybe going towards membership here, anyone with questions that you might have and you just want to know more of who we are and what we believe. We're going to host this virtually by Zoom, and so once we get enough folks that are interested, we're going to have that class. And so if that applies to you or if you know of someone that would be interested, please pass that along to them, and we'd love to help you with any questions that you might have there. And you can see the email address that you can reach out to printed there. There's also printed here some announcements about upcoming ministry events and functions in men's ministry, women's ministry, youth ministry. And so if any of that applies to you, we'd love to welcome you and invite you. Avail yourself to those opportunities, and We'd love for you to enter back into life and fellowship here at Cornerstone as we open back up. And so there are some other things that you can see there and read on your own time. But again, we welcome you to Cornerstone. Glad that you're here, and it's good to be in the house of the Lord together.
Thank you. I'm Tony Giles, one of the pastors. Want to extend that welcome as well. Glad that you're here with us today, a live stream or in person. Want to welcome the name of the Lord. As we gather today, as we do week after week, regardless of the format, we come together on purpose. We come together around a notion, and that is the notion that God is for real, that He has spoken, and He calls us to Himself. And we come into that from all different kinds of places. Today, we are going to take up a psalm that might rightly be described as a psalm of struggle. And so if you struggle, and you do, you may be between struggles right now, but as we live in this world, we learn that struggle is a part of it. And what we find in this word and this liturgy that we have shaped together this week around this notion of how do we live and how do we love and how do we plant our feet in such a way that we can walk in truth, that we can walk with a poise, that we can walk with a direction that has life at the heart of it. How do we do that in a broken world? And this world is broken. You know, we've learned that. We continue to see it week by week and day by day. And we come into that because God calls us to Himself as His people in this world that is broken and where we know struggle that is real. Whether it's ours or others, it is before us and we are in it. And in the midst of that, we find one who is with us. That's what we find. And that's our expectation as we come to His Word this morning, as we sing, as we pray, as we walk through this service together. It's with that anticipation that there's one with us who knows what it's like to live in this world and struggle. And He's with us in the midst of ours. So we do that as we join our hearts, as we join our voices, as we pray to Him. And the one who calls us to worship is the one that we were made to worship. And as we step into worship, we do that for which we were made, with song, with word, with prayers, with the sacrament, and we do so together as His people. To that end, let's stand and let's sing. There is none like You among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like Yours. All the nations You have made shall come and worship before You, O Lord, and shall glorify Your name. For You are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me Your way, O Lord, that I may walk in Your truth. Unite my heart to fear Your name. I give thanks to You, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify Your name forever. For great is Your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol.
Sing and triumph ever. Our New Testament reading this morning comes from the book of 2 John, the first chapter, verses 1 through 6. The elder to the elect lady and her children, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but also all who know the truth, because of the truth that abides in us and will be with us forever. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Father's Son, in truth and love. I rejoice greatly to find some of your children walking in the truth, just as we were commanded by the Father. And now I ask you, dear lady, not as though I were writing you a new commandment, but the one we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated.
A few weeks ago, I got ambitious on a Saturday morning and pulled out my pressure washer and went to work on the walkway leading up to my front door. That didn't look like that big of a project. I thought it might take maybe an hour. But an hour into it, I think I had moved maybe 3 square feet from where I had started because the stain that had latched itself onto the sidewalk there in front of my front door was way more than I had bargained for. And my pressure washer just wasn't strong enough. It couldn't do it. It didn't have the pounds per square inch, the kind of pressure that it needed to lift the heavy stain that had attached itself to my sidewalk. And I felt the helplessness of not having the tools necessary to do the job. And here in Psalm 51, King David is lamenting and confessing the same thing. He's looking at his own heart. He's looking at his story, and he's even face to face with his own shame and guilt. And he says, God, I don't have the tools to lift the stain. My best intentions can't do it. Feeling bad enough about my sin can't do it. My best efforts to reform myself and to do better, they can't lift the stain and they can't wash me. And here David teaches us that what we need is not just a surface washing. To carry the illustration forward a little bit more, we need a new sidewalk. We need God to tear it up and give us a new heart. A heart that's not so infatuated and in love with all of the wrong things. We need to be scrubbed clean of our sin and our shame. And God promises to do that by his own blood, that he alone has the tools necessary to scrub us clean and to wash us so that we will be white as snow. He invites us to do that this morning. And so let us take ourselves to him, not the self that we think we are or that we want others to think that we are, but the self that we truly are in God's presence. Let's walk forward into the light and confess our sins together. Have mercy, O God, on me, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness, and let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Father in heaven, we come before your throne of grace, begging for your mercy, begging for your mercy according to your steadfast love, not according to our merit, not according to our best intentions, not according to the degree of sincerity of our hearts, but only according to your abundant mercy and your steadfast love. O Lord, blot out our sins. We cry out for mercy, saying that you would you hide your face from our sins? And the great confidence that we have that we can cry out to you that very prayer, those words, is that we know that you hid your face from your Son as he bore our sins, as he took on our guilt and our shame. Oh Lord, blot out our iniquities in the name of our perfect substitute, who was blotted out in our place. And, O Lord, create in us clean hearts. We don't just need more instruction. We don't just need to be told the right things. We need our hearts to be rewired and remade from the inside out. For, O Lord, we need our spirits to be right. We've not just done wrong things. We have been wrong. And we cry for your forgiveness and pray that you would renew a right spirit within us. And we ask, O Lord, that you would restore to us the joy of this salvation, the joy of the salvation that comes from outside in, that brings wholeness to brokenness, and that brings newness where there was only dead. O Lord, uphold us with a willing spirit, O God, and create in us a new heart, we pray. And we ask this, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen. The good news of the gospel that we see all over the place in Scripture, but we see especially here in Ezekiel 36, is that this prayer that God would give us a new heart, it's not just words. God himself says, I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean from all of your uncleannesses. and from all of your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and to be careful to obey my rules. You shall dwell in the land that I gave to your forefathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. Brothers and sisters, that promise that I will be your God and you will be my people, that is the engine that has been driving forward God's purposes, not only in this world, but in your life. And nothing can break that promise. Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ. And because of that, we sing. Because of that, we rejoice. Let us stand and sing together.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that your light of Christ might be seen today in our eyes.
God never speaks with more clarity or authority than he does in the reading of his word. I invite you to give your attention as we read Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love. For they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right, and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Who is the man who fears the Lord? Him will he instruct in the way that he should choose. His soul shall abide in well-being, and his offspring shall inherit the land. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Consider my affliction and my trouble, and forgive all my sins. Consider how many are my foes, with what violent hatred they hate me. O, guard my soul and deliver me. Let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all his troubles. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. You may be seated. Oh, Father, we come before you and bow before you and ask you to do what you only can do. Guide us, O Lord, by your word and spirit, that in your light we may see light, that in your truth we may find freedom, in your will discover your peace. Teach us, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Well, if there's an upside to a pandemic, it's that you got more house projects done, Ben. Or maybe you read another book or two that has been waiting you. I did a little of both. One of the books that made its way to the top and altered my life a bit is a book entitled Endurance by Alfred Lansing. It's the story of Ernest Shackleton, which will sound familiar to some of you, perhaps. Ernest Shackleton took a crew of 26 for what was to have been the very first trans-Antarctica expedition. That was the plan. That was the sketched out hope and dream of a crew that in 1914 took sail and ended up in Antarctica. And at the risk of spoiling the story, but it is history, after all, the story is told, it is before you, it's unchanging, and some of you do know that that trans-Antarctic expedition never happened. Well, they got there, but what they sought out to do, they were unable to do, and what they did instead is actually more spectacular than they had ever hoped to achieve. The boat, Endurance was the name of the boat, and that boat was trapped and crushed by pack ice, which I now have a healthy respect for. Pack ice in Antarctica crushed a sailing vessel, and it destroyed it and left it frozen. And so this band of 26 plus and a few dogs made this effort to survive. It's an epic story of struggle, if there ever was one. Weather conditions, dwindling food supply, and literally no one knew where they were, literally. An epic story of struggle that is a fascinating account of endurance, literally, but also how to live through struggle with endurance. You know, you could live for a while in this world with the illusion, under the illusion, that you can go through life in this world without struggle. Now, I might have said that without qualifying it only a few weeks ago. But the reality of the thought of living in this world without struggle and being able to say that may be entirely due to the color of my skin. Because what we have learned is that there's different kinds of struggle. There's the struggle that is episodic, that is occasional, that's maybe you are living between two struggles right now. There's a kind of struggle that is lifelong for many. But whether your struggle is episodic or lifelong, the reality is that we need a path. And we need something more than endurance. We need someone with us in the struggle. Our nation needs a path, it seems. We're looking for statesmen that will show us the way through this national collective struggle. But whether it's national or as localized as your own skin and life, struggle is real. And it is before us. When we come to Psalm 25, we find what has been described as a song of wisdom and a song of struggle that includes a personal lament. It's really a mixed bag. It is a psalm of wisdom in one sense, but there's enough lament in this psalm that you step into David's world as you then step into yours and learn something about your own struggle from his. Picture this. You're hiking off trail, so there's no path. You have a sprained ankle and no water. That's a bit of a dilemma, stretching the image a bit, but that's not unlike what David is describing. At best, the struggle that you and I experience in this world impairs our walk. It impairs our ability to walk well. Struggle does that. At worst, struggle can derail us along the way. And in every case, we need to pay attention to struggle and to learn what God would have us know as we seek to walk in the truth as we struggle. That's what this psalm is about. What does it look like to walk in truth while we struggle? Psalm 1 is where all the psalms begin, right? You might think of Psalm 1 as a signpost, which directs the wise person to the choice of the right road. That's really what Psalm 1 is about. Psalm 25, we might think of as a companion psalm for use along the way. So Psalm 1 lays before us two roads. Psalm 25 becomes a companion guide for us while we are on that way, because struggle will happen. Troubles will come. And then what do we do? What we learn with David is that God will never let you down, friends. He will never let you down while you learn what it means to walk in the truth in struggle. He'll never let you down. I'm going to try to get at this by asking three questions and answering them with you. The questions are these. What is the nature of our struggle? What is the nature of our struggle in this world? What do we need in the midst of that struggle? And how do we move through that struggle into a place of hope? What is the nature of our struggle? What do we need in the midst of that struggle? And how do we move through that struggle to a place of hope? What is the nature of our struggle? When we read through this psalm, we learn two things about struggle. We learn first that struggle is real. Struggle is real. Now, I don't have to tell some of you that struggle is real. There are philosophies in the world and religions that would suggest that struggle is something of a way of thinking and an illusion, that if we can just get around that way of thinking, we come out in a better place. But what we see in David's life as he describes his own struggle is that struggle is real. We see that when he looks around and he sees enemies. He sees enemies, foes. He's talking about real people with weapons who are out to get him. That may not be your struggle. You may have foes and enemies that have maybe not weapons, they may have words, they may have other ways of undermining you and crushing you, but we have struggles in this world. It's a broken world. It is not as God designed this world, and beginning with Cain and Abel, we begin to see how fractured the world is and is now. It's real. When he looks around, he sees darkness, and he doesn't see the path, and that's a reality. And if you've ever been lost in the woods at night, you get a little bit of an idea of how David's describing his own walk right now. It's a real struggle. But the struggles are not only real. The second thing, as we learn from this, is the struggle is powerful. The struggles that you encounter have a power and an ability to, let's say, knock you off your feet. Or another metaphor is pull the rug out from under you. Struggles are powerful, and they come at us, and they do damage. They damage us, and so they impair us in some way, and they inflict something upon us. What we read about is David describes his struggles, verse 17, he calls them distress. That's the power of struggle. It creates a distress in my life where there was a placid sort of alignment of all the pieces of my life, like a calm sea. It's now turbulent. And as the crew of Endurance figured out, turbulent waves are difficult. And so is life in this world, distress and anxiety and misery. He describes himself as lonely. And we know what that's like. We know what it's like to be alone. We know what it's like to be lonely. But the loneliness and the aloneness is magnified when we're alone and struggle. When things are going well and we're alone, I can handle that. But when we are lonely in the midst of struggle, it is unbearable. The nature of our struggles are real and they are powerful. And you recognize some of those, right? I mean, you've been there, or maybe you are there. So what do we need? What is it that we need in the midst of struggle? We can look at this when we see what David prays for. And actually, that's what this is. It's a prayer. And David's prayer is there for you and me to pray. That's how the Psalms work, by the way. We're not simply eavesdropping on David's life. We're invited to take David's vocabulary and make it our own. And what does David cry out for? It's curious that he doesn't use a word that even resembles endurance. I mean, that's where I'm going. In the midst of struggle, what do I need? Endurance. When I'm on a long, long, long bike ride of sorts or a long, long hike, what I need is endurance and stamina to get through. David doesn't exactly word it that way. Now, that may be a benefit or a fruit of what he does pray, but what he's praying in the midst of struggle is not for endurance. He prays first for rescue. Look at verse 15. He says, pluck my feet out of the net. I'm trapped, and I can't get out of this net. Would you help me get out of this net? Because I can't. Verse 17, he says, bring me out of my distress. Not just look at me in my distress, but bring me out of it. Verse 20, guard my soul and deliver me. Get me through this. Get me in a better place. And he's praying for rescue. Just as that crew of Endurance would have certainly recognized, they need something that they don't have. And David prays for rescue. Now, the dilemma I know where your head is going right now, when we say, God, pluck my feet out of the net, bring me out of my stress, we have a timetable in mind that is not always his. And sometimes, for reasons that are unknown to us, he leaves us in the struggle. And the struggle that is battering at your soul may be an old one. But the prayer is the same. Lord, deliver my feet from the net. Pluck my feet. Bring me out. And we fall back, and we'll get to this in a moment, we fall back into the character of the rescuer. Not so much his timing, but his character and his promise. That's the first thing, though. In the midst of struggle, what do we need? We need rescue. We need to get undone from the net that has us wrapped up. But the thing that David prays for with the most, using the most words, it seems, in the psalm is he prays for guidance. He's looking for guidance to know how to live through this struggle. He says, look for a moment at verses 4 and 5. Here it is. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. Teach me, show me, make me know. I need guidance. One translation of verse 4 puts it like this. Show me the path where I should walk, O Lord. Point out the right road for me to follow. Michael Wilcock is a commentator, and as he comes to Psalm 25, here's what he offers us. Psalm 25 has a good deal to say about guiding and showing, about paths and ways, and specifically about God showing his ways to us. When we ask for guidance, and we do, and we will, when we ask for guidance, we may have in mind a particular kind of situation, such as, namely, facing some personal choice which warrants a special pointer from God. The pointer is needed, we feel, when an important decision is to be made, and both possibilities seem equally good, but neither seems obviously right. So we need some handwriting on the wall. But that's not what Psalm 25 is about when he writes and asks God to show him his ways. You see, when we set the guidance text in Psalm 25, and there are several, I read a few, when we set those in the context of the whole psalm, which is important, and we read that against the background of Psalm 1, remember, a different picture emerges, for it's out of Psalm 1 that Psalm 25 grows. Both, as I said, are wisdom poetry. Both say, if you are wise, these are the down-to-earth practical ways in which you will walk. You'll choose the way of the righteous, not the way of the wicked. Both point forward to the regular way the New Testament uses the word walk. Paul uses it all the time as a metaphor for practical Christian living. The guidance that David prays for is what we would call practical Christian living. How do we exercise good judgment along the way? How do we use our reason, and we are made as rational creatures in the image of God who comes to us with his word and says, here. I love the way John Newton, this is from a book entitled The Letters of John Newton, which is chock full of helpful ways of thinking about a number of topics. And when it comes to guidance, this is what he says. He asks the question, how then may the Lord's guidance be expected? And here's his answer. In general, God guides and directs his people by affording them, in answer to prayer, David prays, the light of his Holy Spirit, which enables them to understand and to love the scriptures. The word of God is not to be used as a lottery, nor is it designed to instruct us by shreds and scraps, taking a verse here and a verse there, which detached from their proper places have no determinate import, but it is to furnish us with just principles, right apprehensions, to regulate our judgments and affections, and thereby to influence and direct our conduct. You won't find a specific verse getting you through a specific struggle, probably. But there are principles. There are apprehensions that if once we take them on, influence and direct our conduct. He says, the word of God dwells richly in them as a preservative from error, a light to their feet, and a spring of strength and consolation. By treasuring up the doctrines, precepts, promises, examples, and exhortations of Scripture in our minds, and daily comparing ourselves with the rule by which we walk, we grow into an habitual frame of spiritual wisdom. We grow in wisdom. We grow in knowledge. And we acquire a gracious taste which enables us to judge right and wrong with a degree of readiness and certainty as a musical ear judges sounds. It's a beautiful picture. It's a little bit what a friend of mine, when reading Romans 12, says, let your mind be renewed. He says, what we do is we study God's word and we use then some sanctified common sense as we live our life in this world. Sanctified and guided by what we do know to be true, bringing the principles and the apprehensions to bear as we live our life in this world. And John Newton touched on two things. There's actually two ways he gives us his guidance. One is the word of God, and John Newton used the word spirit, didn't he? Did you hear that? The word and the spirit are where the guidance comes from as we learn to walk in the truth while we struggle. Proverbs 1, we read, verse 23, I will pour out my spirit to you. I will make my words known to you. Do you hear it there? I will pour out my spirit. I will make my words known to you. They belong together. In fact, we would assert that to the degree that God uses the reading of his word in any sermon that you happen to participate in with your ears and hearts today, it's because the Spirit of God takes the truth of God and applies it to the hearts of the people of God. That's our hope and prayer as we gather here week by week, that it's the Spirit who does that work. Proverbs 2, wisdom will come into your heart. Wisdom will come into your heart. That new heart that we read about in Ezekiel 36, and if you read that whole context, and it was there, go back and look at it. I will give you a new heart. I will cause my spirit to live in you, and he will cause you to what? To walk. It is the Spirit who orders our steps, informs our mind, and guides our steps. It's word and spirit. That's where the guidance comes from. That's how God guides his people. But I have a question before we go any further. And it's this. Are you assured that the will of God is better than what you want for your life? Are you convinced of that? Are you assured that what God will reveal in his word is better than what you want for your life? That's where David is. That's where he invites us to go. But no sooner does he declare, say yes to that and say, that's what I want. I want to know the will of God. And I want to walk in his ways. No sooner does he declare his purpose to walk in those ways that he recalls his failure to do so. So it's not only guidance, it's not only deliverance that we need in the midst of our struggle with David. We need forgiveness. Michael Wilcock again says, if David cannot see the way ahead, it is as likely due to his own bias towards sin as it is to the antagonism of others. If he can't see the way, it's more likely that it's due to the brokenness of his own life. That's why in verses 6 and 7 he says, remember not my sins. Remember your mercy, but don't remember my sins. That's why in Psalm 51, which we heard earlier, the same David cries out and says, hide your face from my sins. Because he knows he needs forgiveness. It's not enough to know which way to walk and how to walk. It's taking into account that there's something broken in us that won't get there. So he prays for forgiveness. Spurgeon on this passage says, we are usually tempted in seasons of affliction or struggle to fear that our God has forgotten us or forgotten his usual kindness towards us. Is that you? Have you gotten to a place in your intent to walk in the truth that your struggle raises another question? Has God forgotten me because of my failure? Has he dropped me into another category of potential objects of his affection? I want to love you. I want to meet you where you are, but if you're not going to meet me halfway, then I don't know. Is that how you hear God's response to your own failures? I love the way Spurgeon put it, that we have a tendency to think that he has forgotten his usual kindness towards us. But you know that's not the end of the story. He does respond to our struggle. He responds to our sin. And we're about to get there. So that's the nature of our struggle. That's what we need in the midst of struggle. We need rescue. We need guidance. We need forgiveness. So then how do we move through this struggle? I've already hinted at it a little bit. But we see David taking three postures, at least, in this psalm. The first thing that we see in David that shows us how we are to move through this struggle is that we are to have what David displays and what I'll call a patient confidence. You see, underlying these pleas for protection and guidance and forgiveness, as he pleads, there's an assumption or a conviction underneath. And it's this. David prays those prayers. He makes those pleas because he believes that God is the sort of God who will do it. He's learned enough about God to know that he is faithful to his promises and that he is present even when it's not obvious. There's a conviction that underlies those pleas. And so the question is, what is the conviction that underlies the prayers of your heart, the cries of your heart? Do you know, like David, that there's a God underneath it all and above it all that hears those prayers, hears those cries in the midst of struggle, and he moves toward you? David's convinced of it. You see, you don't trust a person unless you really know him. I mean, right? You don't trust some until you really know them. And that generally takes some time and some case studies. Is this someone that I can trust? And relationships will bear that out. Time will bear it out. And if you're about to hire someone, you don't have time. You've got to rely on something. What is it? References. That's why you've been asked to fill and supply references when you go for a job interview. Is this someone I can trust? Does she do what she says? Who knows this person better than I do? That's underneath it. And what we find in David's words here, in verse 8, he says, "Good and upright are you, O Lord." Yours, Lord, is a character that shows that I can trust you. That's the confidence that he has in the midst of struggle. But what did I call it? A patient confidence. Because God's timetable is not ours most of the time. Have you noticed? And so he says, verse 2, "Oh my God, in you I trust." And he expands that in verses 3, 5, and 21 when he says, "People who wait on you win. And so I wait on you. I'm waiting on you. I wait for you all the day long. I wait for you," verse 21. And in verse 15, we see this picture where he says, "My eyes are ever toward the Lord." You see that posture of waiting? My eyes are fixed on the horizon, knowing that you are there, that redemption is there, that deliverance and rescue is there. And there's my hope. It's a patient confidence. But it's not just a patient confidence. There's one more thing, two more things, that David gives us as we look at his posture. We see him patiently, confidently waiting. But we see a ready obedience. And I've already hinted at this, verses 4 and 5. When David says, show me and teach me, what, can't you hear behind those words? I want to know because I want to do something with which you show me. I'm ready to obey. I'm ready to follow. Here's a principle that I've borrowed from Eric Alexander on this text. Are you ready? Consecration of ourselves to do the will of God must always precede the desire to know it. Consecration of ourselves to do the will of God must always precede the desire to know it. Here's another way of saying that. We cannot pretend that we are waiting on God if we do not want to do what he asks. Ooh. We can't pretend that we're waiting if we're not ready to do what he asks. Have you ever been asked this question, will you do something for me? Of course you have. Will you do something for me? Well, what goes through your mind? Well, depends. You know, it's typically our answer. Unless it's someone that you know and trust, and so far they've not asked you to do things that are impossible. But you want to say, it depends on what you're asking me to do. You know what that is? That is a qualified commitment. That's what that is. It's reasonable. But that qualified commitment that is reasonable in a lot of situations, when we move that over and we're talking about God, it's slanderous. It's actually slanderous of God's character when we say, well, it depends. Because David has gone on record, as have most of you, that God is good. We don't understand his ways, but we know he is good. And when God asks us to do something, we don't respond with a qualified, it depends. So how do we move through struggle to hope with patient confidence, a ready obedience, and finally, a larger story? That's how we move through struggle. There's a larger story that we get a hint at when David uses the word, and he refers to the covenant a couple of times. And that is the reality that God, who we are asking him to show us how to walk in truth in the midst of struggle, is one who has already bound himself to us with his steadfast, committed love. There's a larger story, and it's the story of a people and a God who took that people and said, I will be yours and you will be mine. And that larger story comes to the surface in the midst of David's struggles when he's reminding himself that this is a God who's already bound himself to me. But that larger story and the suffering and struggling that David is now experiencing has another element to it. When you take this last section and you read through these prayers of David in the last several verses, what you see is a recognition of forces arrayed against the one who seeks to learn God's ways. He calls them enemies, right? My enemies, my foes, they're real. Count them. Deal with them. There are enemies arrayed against the one who seeks to learn God's way. And these enemies who see this as this precious intimacy between a believer and his Lord as their key target. And the enemies that have surrounded David pale, friends, in comparison to the enemy who arrayed all of his forces against another one. You see, as David prays and he describes distress and troubles, a heart enlarged, a heart exploding with the difficult moment in which he's living, it's a bit of a foreshadow. Like a lot of scripture, it's a bit of a foreshadow. If you were to read, and I would invite you to take a look later at Mark 14, where you see Jesus describing his life, and he describes it as distressed and troubled because of the enemy that had arrayed all of his force to undermine, to pull the rug out from under a plan of redemption. And the purposes of God to meet another one who would struggle. Who would struggle as you and I never will struggle. Whose walk was impaired, can we say, by the weight of the sin of the world. Who took that struggle upon himself. You see, it would be David's greater son who would answer David's plea for protection and deliverance and guidance. And life. In verses 21 and 22, we get a clue of this larger story when he says, integrity and uprightness preserve me. May integrity and uprightness preserve me. But you know what? David doesn't have enough integrity and uprightness to preserve himself. But the one who struggled in his place on a cross is the one whose life is marked by integrity and uprightness. And so David's prayer is answered. Yes, David, integrity and uprightness did preserve you. It does preserve you, church. Integrity and uprightness preserves you in the midst of struggle and enables you to walk well in the midst of struggle, but it's not your own. It's not your own integrity and uprightness and resolve to get through this unscathed. It's the one who walked through it who was everything but unscathed, who took the blows that David's enemies were ready to deliver to him, but on a much more massive scale. You know, we don't fully understand the Psalms until we ask a question. How does Jesus sing this psalm? I don't have to stretch my imagination to think that as Christ entered a garden of Gethsemane, that maybe he prayed, turn to me, Father, my troubles, the troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distress. As we do know, he said, if there's any other way, I'd like to hear it. Consider my affliction and my trouble. He did not pray, forgive all my sins, because it was David's sins and our sins that has him there. Consider how many are my foes. And what violent hatred they hate me. David's words became Jesus' words as they become our words. But the story doesn't end with a struggling, suffering Savior, does it? Christ, who sang in suffering these words, perhaps, sings now in triumph. He sings these words, but in triumph. And he joins his voice with ours as we sing and David's as he prays. Say, that struggle, that request for forgiveness and deliverance, that's what I've done. I have met you in your struggle. And because of that, there is no struggle. There is nothing in this world that can separate you. You will not be abandoned as you walk in this world between your struggles. Or even if that struggle is lifelong. that you are not alone. Finding the way to God doesn't require insight, speculation, or some kind of spiritual sextant, as the crew of endurance used. It's not a set of principles. It's not some tips for living well in this world. The way to finding your way is to find the one who is the way. A person. The person who knows your name. And he knows your struggle. And he comes to you in the midst of that struggle and says, look at me. Eyes fixed here on the one who loves you. The one who is undoing the brokenness of this world and the struggle that is yours today. And in that moment, in that reality, we will be able to say with the Apostle John, as we read earlier, that your children are walking in truth. Because we're made your children by the wonder of your forever love. And we walk in truth, united to you by faith. That's the way we do this. Patient endurance and a Redeemer who calls you by name. Father, would you work those purposes out in our own lives, that we might see you in your beauty, to see you in your presence, that what we have to bring to you today is hearts that are in need of forgiveness, and we find that in you. That the hearts that want to obey, and that is a result of your Spirit at work in us. So the Spirit that you have implanted in us, do continue to do that work to cause us to walk in your ways with hearts that are made alive with joy because of the goodness of our God and the beauty of our Redeemer, Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please stand. Let's sing.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Indeed, it is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Children of the living God, let us profess our faith together. I ask you, what is it that you believe? We believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell.
On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and now sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Just a reminder to you today as we celebrate the sacrament, the table together, that ushers will indicate your time to come forward. And as you do, you'll go to either side and you'll find two cups in that tray, the top cup being wine or juice and the bottom cup bread. And you simply separate those two, partake of the elements, and there's a trash can on each side of the table. That's our method here for now. It was a suffering, struggling Savior that made his way to the cross. But make no mistake about it, friends, it's not a suffering, struggling Savior who hosts this table today. That one who struggled on your behalf is now raised, and he is the host of this table. But I would invite you to remember two features of what it is that we do today. As you take these elements to your lips today, to remember the suffering and the struggle that marks your life in this world, that caused his, that is a part of his, and his struggle to undo the brokenness of this world is on display before us. It was his death that undid the brokenness of this world. And we live between that and a day when we see all things restored. So we remember the struggle, but we also remember the victory and the risen Christ who is our host today. And that sets your struggles in that larger story that we're talking about today. There's a larger story that you are a part of because God has come to you in Christ and says, I'm with you. And my work is to restore all things, including the struggles of your life. If you've made that profession of faith, then he invites you to this, his table. On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body. Eat this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and poured and said, "This is the new covenant of my blood shed for the remission of sins. Drink this, all of you, in remembrance of me." Paul said, "As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And we do that in the presence of one who is not dead but alive. He is your host. He meets you here. It is his gift to his people. Father, would you meet us here? Would you take these very common elements and use them for your purposes to strengthen our faith, to set our struggles in the midst of a larger story that has an end and that has a person in the middle of it? Lord, thank you for your presence with us, and use this, your table, to grow us in our faith and to whet our appetite for the world to come. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Come to the table.
Before we pray, I want to direct your attention to the pastoral notes that's in the bulletin this week and that also went out by email this week. Just in case you haven't heard, in the pastoral notes, Nate brings us into the big news of their family, which is that they are expecting a fifth child, and that this child has a high probability of being born with Down syndrome. And so I would encourage you to read his letter and his note to us as a church, and let us continue to pray for them and to walk with them in a season of real joy and excitement, but also uncertainty and fear. And so with that in mind, let us go before the throne of grace in prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the reminder once again that you are big enough and strong enough and wise enough and loving enough to harness all of the struggle and all of the pain and all of the brokenness in your people's lives, to harness it up to produce something beautiful, something good, and something that we are much too small and limited to imagine. Thank you for the reminder that all things are indeed working for your glory and for our good, even the episodes of struggle. And Lord, we thank you for that reminder, because all of us can feel that and know that. Indeed, as Tony reminded us, it is real. We thank you, Lord, that this table that we have participated in just now and that you have hosted for us, that is just a sample of the feast that is to come, it is a real tangible sign of the truth and the reality that you are redeeming our struggles through your own struggle. That the struggle that was for you death has brought for us life. And that, O Lord, gives us the patient confidence to keep putting one foot in front of the next in this world that you call us into, waiting patiently and living faithfully. Oh God, we thank you that nothing can separate us from your love, but indeed, because we are those that you have made covenant promises to, indeed all things must work together for our salvation. Lord, help us to live in view of this story, and even to see the struggles that might even be up to our neck or above our eyes this morning. Help us to know and to see those struggles in light of the bigger picture that you are redeeming this world, making all things new, and redeeming us in that, O Lord. Lord, we pray that for Nate and for his family as they walk into a season of real joy and yet also real uncertainty and unknown. We pray that you would give them the grace, Lord, to remember your promises, to rest in the peace of who you are and what you are doing. Lord, we pray that you would give them grace for each day as the day requires it. Give them their daily bread. And even more than that, give them the faith that you will give them their daily bread. Lord, we walk with them through this season of real joy and also real fear, trusting that you are the one who makes all things new. And we do pray for the health of their child. We pray that you would write this story in a way that is so much bigger and grander and more beautiful than we have the minds or the hearts to imagine. And we look to you, O Lord, in this. Indeed, on this Father's Day, O Lord, we remember and we celebrate the fathers among us. We thank you for those who have modeled for us Christ's likeness and your love for us. We remember the fathers who are no longer with us. Indeed, as days like this can also be painful to remember fathers who have either gone before, or even the wounds from fathers who did not model and demonstrate your likeness. But in all of these things, O Lord, even the best fathers are broken fathers, and this day reminds us of our constant need, all of us, to be fathered by you, to be fathered more and more into your likeness, formed and shaped according to your character. And so we remember that, O Lord, and we thank you for what this day means and invites us to celebrate. There's so many other things that we can pray for, so many things on our hearts, so many things that are perhaps weighing us down or distracting us. Oh God, teach us to have this prayer that you taught us to pray always on our lips as we walk out into this world that you call us, with all of the unknowns, all of the uncertainties, knowing that you are a God who is always with us. And so we pray this prayer that you've taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.
Remind you as we leave today that we'll dismiss row by row, beginning in the back. The ushers will guide you and help you. But we're delighted that you're a part of our gathering this morning and ask you now to receive the benediction, God's good word to you. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Amen.